Distinguished guests, welcome to the Speakasser conference series. Our guest tonight is Elizabeth Bowling. She teaches at Pittsburgh University. She works on 19th century art. And she has extensive research on Picasso's art. May I say something? Kanal 1'i ayarlamanız gerektiği söylen duydunuz mu efendim? Simultane tercüme için kanal 1'i ayarlayacaksınız.
Thank you.
Teşekkürler.
Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you can hear me and I apologize for not speaking in Turkish. On the left you have a self-portrait of Picasso. He took this photograph himself, dressed as an artisan. It was taken in about 1915. On the right you have a plaster cast of Picasso's hand. He made the cast himself in about 1937. Maybe we could have the lights off.
Belki ışıkları söndürebiliriz.
The lights.
Işıklar lütfen.
It is anyway for me a very great pleasure and an honor to be here in Istanbul speaking to you this evening in this series of lectures devoted to the work of Picasso. I'm very pleased to be in Istanbul again. I haven't been here for 40 years. I came when I was an undergraduate student. And of course the city has changed. And it's wonderful to see this museum and this fascinating exhibition. This evening my subject is Picasso's constructed sculpture, represented in this exhibition by several important pieces. It's no exaggeration to say that in creating his first cubist constructions in 1912 to 1914, Picasso initiated a conceptual and a technical revolution that changed forever the face of Western sculpture. Works like these two, Caro, the window, Anthony Caro of 1966 to 67, Tony Cragg, Instinctive Reactions, which is on the right, of 1987, they would not be possible without Picasso's pioneering sculptures. Indeed, it might be argued that his influence on the evolution of 20th century sculpture has been greater and more radical than his influence on any other medium, including painting. But to grasp how and why Picasso decided to make sculpture by assembling disparate elements together, one needs to know something about the sculptures he made before this great breakthrough. Picasso was trained to be a painter, not a sculptor. But from the very start, that training involved making drawings after plaster casts of famous antique marbles, like this drawing here, made when he was about 14 years old, 13 or 14 years old. And it's clear even from very early paintings, like Girl with Bare Feet of 1895, that he was fascinated above all by the human figure, and also that he tended to see the human figure not as a decorative shape silhouetted against a flat background, but as a three-dimensional object occupying three-dimensional space and projecting physically towards the spectator. He had, in other words, a sculptor's vision of the world, and it is therefore not surprising that he soon began quite tentatively at first, to make sculptures himself.
Birlikte heykel yapmaya kısa süre içinde başlaması hiç şaşırtıcı değildir.
In this exhibition, you can see one of the most important of his early sculptures, Head of a Woman, Fernand Olivier, of 1906. It is a very sensitive, tender and dignified portrait of his lover, but it cannot be called revolutionary. You could compare it with innumerable classical fragments or Renaissance portraits, and the modeling technique, it was modeled in clay, is suggestive and impressionistic in the manner of late 19th century masters such as Rodin. This is Rodin's Head of Camille Claudel. 3 years later, Picasso created another life-size sculpture inspired by Fernand Olivier, the same woman, Head of a Woman, Autumn 1909. This is far more radical in appearance because it's very abstracted and analytical. By this time, Picasso had already been working closely with Georges Braque for over a year, and one can see immediately that this new head develops from paintings in the geometricized, faceted style of early cubism, such as this painting, Woman with Pears, which was done in the summer of 1909, just a few months before this sculpture. Between 1906 and 1909, Picasso had been experimenting with wood carving in a deliberately rough and primitive manner. Standing Woman of 1908 on the right. And this experience of cutting deeply into wood undoubtedly influenced the modeling technique he used in the Cubist Head of a Woman, in which the clay has been excavated with a knife just as if it were wood, same sort of technique. Significantly, Picasso later reworked this sculpture, the plaster cast of it, with a knife before it was cast in bronze. So he was fusing two alternative traditional techniques of modeling, in which one builds up the forms rather in the manner of painting, and carving, in which one extracts the forms from the original block of marble, stone or wood by cutting away extraneous material. However, both modeling and carving had certain drawbacks for Picasso. He had no technical training in either method, and although he got help from sculptor friends, he did not have the expertise or the confidence to work on a large scale. Worse, he found the business of carving terribly slow and laborious, and modeling was fraught with difficulty if the clay was too wet or too dry. He could finish several paintings in the time that it took him to rough out a figure in wood or model a head in clay. And at the end of the day, comparable paintings looked much more powerful and more monumental than the sculptures. Seated Woman of 1908 is a very large painting, and I think it's a much stronger or more powerful painting than the wooden sculpture of the same date. Furthermore, Picasso preferred working alone and being in complete control of the end product, relying on sculptor friends to lend him tools and give him technical tips, and on bronze founders to produce the finished pieces, did not appeal to him. So at this stage, his sculpture was undeniably subservient to his painting, and he made very few works, only 26 in total between 1902 and 1911, which for someone of his prodigious output is a tiny number. He had not yet found a technique which suited his inventive gifts or his quick-fire temperament.
Için uygun teknik henüz olmamıştır.
The breakthrough came in the autumn of 1912 with the famous cardboard and string relief construction of a guitar. I'm also showing you the sheet metal version made in 1914. This measures 66 centimeters high. And although so fragile, it looks astonishingly bold and dramatic when it is hung, as it should be, quite high up on a wall. With hindsight, we can see how it came to be made at this moment. And various factors were involved. Georges Braque, Picasso's collaborator in the creation of Cubism, had been making ephemeral sculptural constructions in paper and cardboard since sometime in 1911, but none survived, and so we don't know what they looked like. However, they must have impressed Picasso to the extent, at least, that he wanted to go one further, for there was a streak of highly stimulating rivalry in their relationship. Meanwhile, in the course of the spring and summer of 1912, Picasso made a large number of abstracted figure drawings, such as this seated musician made in the summer of 1912. These drawings suggest that if the figure were to be realized in three dimensions, it would have to be constructed like a utilitarian object, such as a ladder or a kitchen chair, from bits and pieces of wood, glued or nailed or held together by some other means. Evidently, Picasso was posing the question to himself, why not make sculpture by joinery rather than by modeling or carving? Picasso already owned a collection of African masks, and some of these were constructed using simple joinery methods. So he had that vital precedent to encourage him. This is a Gribeau mask from the Ivory Coast, which was in Picasso's collection, and it is a constructed piece, various pieces of wood nailed together, stuck together. Furthermore, Picasso was surrounded by objects, including guitars and violins, which are constructions. And it's very likely that he had seen technical manuals with illustrations showing how such objects are actually made. This is a diagram of a violin from a manufacturer's manual made in pieces, like Picasso's own guitar. He had probably also watched craftsmen making these objects. In Montmartre, in Paris, Picasso lived down the road from a celebrated Spanish guitar maker called Ramirez. And with his well-known fondness for gossiping with his compatriots and his love of Spanish gypsy music, it is inconceivable that he did not pass the time of day sometimes with Ramirez in his little boutique. The ultimate prompt came from his own experiments with sticking scraps of material onto the surfaces of paintings in the spring of 1912. Here is the still life with chair caning of the spring of 1912, and this is a piece of imitation chair caning stuck on it. And he also, like Braque, had made his first papier-collé stuck paperworks in the autumn of 1912. This work precedes the guitar here and is made with wallpaper and other pieces of cut paper. The collage and papier-collé techniques involved, of course, finding the appropriate material, cutting it out, and placing it in a composition, and then fixing it down. It's an artisan's technique, a bricolage technique. It is not a revolutionary technique in itself. For every day of our lives, we use things that have been made in this way, and many of us will have assembled these things ourselves. But in the context of the high art medium of sculpture, as it's traditionally conceived in the West, assemblage was absolutely revolutionary. And when several of Picasso's early constructions were illustrated in the avant-garde periodical Les Soirées de Paris in November 1913, it is said that most of the subscribers were so outraged that they cancelled their subscriptions.
Bazı aboneler o kadar kızmışlar ki
Once Picasso realized that he could assemble sculptures, there was no stopping him. This is a guitar made in 1912-13. The technique suited him perfectly for various reasons. He could work as fast as when he was drawing or painting. He did not need any help from specialists, and the materials and tools could be bought inexpensively from almost any hardware shop. He could make use of things lying around in his studio, and that really pleased him because he hated throwing anything away. And considered humble, utilitarian things like cardboard boxes, little miracles of engineering. This is in fact a cardboard box, which has been opened out. He could reintroduce color into the art of sculpture, either by using colored materials or by slapping on some colored paint here and there. And rather than sticking to figurative subjects, he could extend the range of sculpture's subject matter by branching into still life, and thus matching the assemblage technique to the objects depicted. Thus, a real guitar is a construction. Its essence is to be hollow. So whereas it is madness to model it in clay or carve it out of a block of wood, it is entirely appropriate to assemble it from flat and curved planes and to show, by leaving it open, that it really is a hollow box.
Eğimli bir takım düzlemlerden bunu yapmak gayet anlamlıdır. Çünkü kutudur.
Equally, isn't it sensible to use a real piece of upholstery fringe when one wants to depict a table covered with a fringed cloth? This is the still life of 1914. And with this assemblage method, he could work directly with his hands, something he greatly enjoyed doing, for he was proud of his dexterity and the strength of his hands. Think of that cast, that plaster cast of his hand, which I showed you at the start. Assemblage was also great fun. One could be a child again, playing with a box of bricks. It was a welcome escape from the arduous discipline and the routine of painting. And from this time onwards, autumn 1912, with very few exceptions, Picasso dropped any thought of being a professional sculptor. And for the next 40 years, he resisted any suggestion that he should, for instance, create editions of his sculpture and sell them through his dealer, as other sculptors do. Only in the 1950s and 1960s did he occasionally relax this rule, permitting the creation of several monumental enlargements of his own small-scale constructions for public spaces in various cities throughout the world, including Chicago and Stockholm. That is why practically all his sculpture from 1912 until he stopped making sculpture in the mid-1960s was in his own collection at the time of his death, and why the best place to see it is in the Musée Picasso in Paris, which was founded with works taken by the state in lieu of death duties. For Picasso, his sculptures had no commercial value. Instead, they were treated rather like members of his extended family, and if solid enough, they were put to use. Thus, the children rode on the back of the bronze goat, which I'll show you again later, and his pet goat was tethered to its tail. There is an aspect of Picasso's constructed sculptures which I have not mentioned yet, but which was, I believe, a vital component. Transformation. When, for example, Picasso took an empty can that had contained dry milk powder, this sculpture is called Still Life with Bottle of Bass, but it was made from an empty milk can. When he took that empty can, cut it with shears, folded the metal this way and that, and painted it here and there so that it represented a still life with a bottle of Bass beer, a glass, and a newspaper, he transformed that humble can beyond recognition in a way that seems almost magical and is very amusing once one realizes what has happened. At the same time, he made sure that there was a structural relationship between the original tin can and the objects it depicted once it had been transformed. For a bottle is a hollow container, like a can, and it contains a sustaining liquid, like milk. A glass is hollow too, and like the can and the bottle, it is round in section. A newspaper is a series of flat sheets that can be rolled and folded, just as the flat sheet of tin was rolled and folded to form the can in the factory where it was made. And Picasso drew attention to the transformation by leaving bits of the old label and the impressed lettering visible. Once one is alert to this aspect of Picasso's constructions, it becomes fascinating to speculate about the nature of the transformation of the ready-made materials that he's used, and to reflect upon how those materials relate to the objects into which he transforms them. Often the interventions allowed him to introduce a truly poetic quality, in that the object he is ostensibly depicting looks like and reminds one of something else. So the plastic equivalent of poetic simile or metaphor is involved.
Bir teşbihin veya metaforun plastik bir eşdeğeri çıkmıştır.
Take for the famous absinthe glass of 1914, for example. This was exceptionally cast from the original wax model in an edition of 6 bronzes at the suggestion of Picasso's dealer, Daniel Henry Kahnweiler. Each cast was then decorated in a different manner so that all 6 are in effect unique. The glass itself is about the size of a real absinthe glass, and it has been opened up in the classic cubist manner to reveal the hollow containing interior and an inner horizontal plane represents the top surface of the liquid. The spoon fixed on the top with a sugar lump. The spoon is a real silver-plated absinthe spoon, and it is therefore a bit like the upholstery fringe on the still life I showed you earlier, strictly realistic. However, placed on the glass at this rakish angle, not to say drunken angle, it looks like a hat and the glass like a head. And depending on how it is decorated, that head may appear feminine or masculine, a woman in a fashionable hat or a sailor in his cap with its streamers. But the head-like character of the absinthe glass is sensed by most spectators. A metaphoric ambience has been created and a transformation has been achieved. The climax of Picasso's cubist constructions came belatedly in 1924 with the dramatic painted sheet metal guitar, which measures well over a meter high. It is a veritable tour de force of cutting and manipulation because, astonishingly, the whole thing has been cut from a single large sheet of metal. Except for the sound hole and the strings, the sound hole was made with a tin without a lid, and the strings are made of lengths of twisted wire. But the whole of the rest is cut from a single sheet of metal. Black, grey and white paint has been quite crudely brushed on to coat and decorate the sheet metal, reinforcing the sense of three-dimensionality, livening up the surfaces to enhance the sense of movement and rhythm, but also to create a sinister and scary ambience. This guitar woman, because Picasso emphasizes the instrument's figurative associations by showing it in this upright stance, standing, and treating the flaps of metal like wind-blown drapery. But this guitar woman is spectral in character, and the way Picasso has opened up the body or torso and painted the white hourglass silhouette on the back inside plate is oddly reminiscent of a coffin, suggestion of death. A couple of years later, Picasso produced a series of guitars concocted from the most disparate materials, each of them framed like a picture. The two largest, this is one of them, made in 1926, are particularly brutal in execution and violent in their implications, since they use dirty and torn material and involve piercing the backing with big, dangerous-looking carpenter's nails. Picasso even meditated fixing naked razor blades on the frame of one of them so that anyone trying to carry it would cut his hands. The construction technique could, in other words, function expressionistically when the materials used were inherently disgusting or low, and when he exploited the innate aggression of the actions of cutting, tearing, piercing, stretching, twisting, nailing down. Very aggressive here. In November 1918, Picasso's great friend, the poet Guillaume Apollinaire, died, and soon afterwards he was commissioned to sculpt a monument for Apollinaire's grave in the cemetery in Paris. As I mentioned earlier, Picasso had never thought of himself as a professional sculptor, and he had never hitherto accepted a public commission. For years, he procrastinated. And it was not until 1927, as the 10th anniversary of Apollinaire's death approached, that he set to work in earnest. As it turned out, the commissioning committee disapproved of every maquette he ever showed them, and he never completed the monument. But planning the monument proved immensely stimulating and drove Picasso to feats of ingenuity that he might never have reached without it. Apollinaire, who was famous for his calligram, poems made like pictures, had been a very radical poet himself, and Picasso felt he had the license to be daringly inventive. The monument had to be large, a couple of meters high at least. It also had to be freestanding. Hitherto, Picasso's sculpture had been relatively small scale. Most of it had taken the form of relief, of wall relief. And since 1912, virtually all of it had represented still life objects, not human figures. For a grave, still life would not do at all. And of course, a monument for an outdoor location must be in a material strong enough to withstand inclement weather. Tin, scraps of wood, let alone cardboard, were totally unsuitable. One of Picasso's solutions was to call upon the Catalan metal worker Julio Gonzalez to help him make a construction in welded iron. For Picasso himself had never done any welding and had none of the necessary equipment. Gonzalez, on the other hand, had a well-equipped atelier in Paris, and he readily agreed to his old friend's proposal. The two men had first met in Barcelona in about 1900. Beginning in 1928 and continuing intermittently for the next 3 or 4 years, the two artists would get together in Gonzalez's workshop and make a series of welded iron sculptures on the basis of Picasso's sketchbook drawings. According to Gonzalez, he'd rarely seen Picasso so happy as when he was hammering away at these new sculptures. The most celebrated and the most complex is the towering Woman in a Garden. You see Picasso standing beside it, which was painted white once it had been completed in 1930. A bronze replica was made by Gonzalez in 1931-1932. This extraordinary work depicts a screaming woman with flowing hair whose body appears to be transforming into plants or to be surrounded by foliage. She is like a cross between a skeleton of a dinosaur in a natural history museum. This is a dinosaur from the Natural History Museum in Paris. I think there's a certain similarity. Cross between that and between Mary Magdalene bewailing the death of Jesus Christ, screaming, arms outstretched, screaming head, long hair, and also cross between them and the mythological Daphne turning into a tree in order to escape Apollo. That is the painting by Pollaiuolo of Apollo and Daphne. But however one interprets this bizarre assemblage, one cannot miss the ingenuity of the bricolage methods used to construct it. And the sheer crudity of some of the welding strongly suggests that Picasso did a lot of the work himself, not Gonzalez, who was a very fine craftsman. Round here, it's very crude, the welding work. In any case, finding, fixing, transforming was certainly involved, because although some of the elements were made especially for the occasion, the philodendron leaves, the hair, the large leaf-like form in the center, these were made specially, many other elements were found lying around on the atelier floor or in some scrap metal yard. For example, the numerous vertical elements, the twisted wire, nails, screws, etc., from which a lot of this sculpture is constructed. And although the sculpture does have a sinister and troubling aspect, with its unequivocal references to the ravages of time and the pain of loss and death, it is also playful and humorous. For instance, the representation of the woman's breasts, vertical rather than horizontal in alignment, with nuts and bolts for the nipples, and two colanders bought in a hardware shop. If one reflects upon the original function of these found objects, spikes, bed springs, colanders, a not very flattering definition of femininity emerges. For if this woman is good in bed, she has a mind like a sieve and can be as hard as nails. Whether Picasso intended such misogynistic associations in choosing these particular objects is an open question, but one can't dismiss the possibility. Nevertheless, they were deployed lyrically, and the result is elegant and graceful in its profile. Meanwhile, Picasso was also modeling figurative sculptures in plaster in a sculpture studio he'd set up in the stables of his newly acquired country house in Normandy, the Chateau de Boisjoli.
This is a photograph of the interior of the stables where he made sculpture. Some of the sculptures are on a very large scale, including an enormous figure of a running woman, which fell apart and has never been repaired. X-rays taken of some of these works, these heads, reveal that Picasso made their armatures from disparate bits and pieces, scrap wood, wire mesh, rags, iron struts, and so forth. And here and there one can see parts of those ramshackle interior skeletons, because he failed to hide them completely beneath the plaster. In short, the armatures wear constructions, although only a very few of the finished sculptures consist of more than one element and can be considered assemblages. One of them is the reclining bather of 1931-32 here, which in its original plaster consisted of two separate pieces, which could be locked together and then taken apart afterwards. It was in this studio that Picasso first discovered the virtues of plaster as a medium. In the first place, it was very cheap, and it could be bought from any builder's merchant, whereas clay was much more difficult to obtain. It dries more quickly than clay, and although it could be modeled like clay when it was still moist, once it had dried, it could be carved as if it were wood or stone, but it's carved much more easily than wood or stone. Plaster is also extremely strong, and if bits fell off or there was surface damage, it was quite easy to repair. For a bricoleur like Picasso, plaster was the ideal medium. And it had another property which it took him some while to understand and to exploit: its traditional associations with casting. For once Picasso had realized that he could take accurate casts in plaster of more or less any found object, there was no stopping him. It was a liberating revelation, akin to the original 1912 revelation of the technique of construction. And it seems to have happened, this revelation, in 1933, not before. At all events, this latest technical revelation set him off on a new creative spurt, and some of his most beautiful and fascinating sculptures were produced on the back of it. A case in point is the lovely, diminutive Woman with Leaves of 1933. Her head is the cast of a small cardboard box, probably a matchbox. Her peplos, her Greek costume, is created from casts of corrugated cardboard. And her branch of leaves is a cast of actual leaves. I think it's from the elm tree. Now, the leaves actually represent themselves, but the corrugated cardboard and the cardboard box involve a highly imaginative transformation, and thus Picasso's legendary ability to see something as something else. On a much larger scale is the orator, also of 1933, with flapping corrugated cardboard drapery and a torso made of chicken wire with plaster pressed through it. Both these sculptures are adapted from familiar classical sculptural types: the Pomona figure, the orator figure, and so is the humorous head of a warrior, which you have in the exhibition, standing in front of the glass window. At this period, Picasso was involved in making illustrations for deluxe editions of Ovid's Metamorphoses and Aristophanes' Lysistrata, and it was natural for him to think in terms of Greco-Roman sculpture. During the German occupation of Paris, 1940-44, Picasso made a number of major sculptures, and occasionally a construction technique was involved. The most famous is the bull's head of 1942, which consists simply of the handlebars and the saddle of a bicycle fixed together. Picasso claimed that he'd found the saddle and the handlebars abandoned in the street and saw them as the head of a bull. He also pointed out that a cyclist happening upon finding his bull's head might decide to take it apart to repair his bicycle, and that there could be an endless sequence of such transformations, from bicycle parts to sculpture, back to bicycle parts, back to sculpture, and so on, forever. But his next major phase of as an assemblage artist belongs to the post-war period, after he had settled in Valoris near Cannes with his new mistress, Françoise Gillot. Her fascinating memoirs, Life with Picasso, give first-hand descriptions of a number of the best pieces and also the foraging exhibitions to the local dumps that they went on together. She pushing an old pram, he tossing into it the likely scrap metal and broken pottery that he found. This photograph taken in 1950 shows Picasso in his studio in Valoris with all the with some of the rubbish that he'd picked up that he used in his sculpture. The sculptures that he made with this rubbish are among Picasso's most delightful and popular works. Baboon and Young of 1951 incorporates in the head two of his son's toy cars placed one on top of the other and a big pottery jar for the pregnant belly of the animal. The goat, which I showed you earlier in bronze, with Picasso's own goat attached to the tail, this is the plaster, the original. This was made in 1950 and is a miraculous concoction of, among other things, a palm frond for the backbone and the forehead, an old basket for the rib cage, which you see here better when the work is unfinished. Sections of branch for the legs, small pottery milk jars for the udders, a piece of metal tubing for the anus, and a bent can for the sex. It will be noticed from this list that in the sculpture of the goat, the chosen object is almost always exactly like in function, as well as in appearance, the thing it represents. For example, a rib cage not only resembles a basket, but it functions as a container and a protector of the human or of the inner organs, like a basket. According to Françoise Gillot, Picasso spoke of these sculptures as plastic metaphors, since there is a perfect fusion between the two elements in the equation: toy cars for the baboon's head, basket for the rib cage, and so on. And as we saw earlier, this poetic quality was already present in his cubist constructions. Picasso delighted in the fact that the spectator was able to observe the alchemical process of transformation, and he took care not to disguise completely the identity of the found objects that he had appropriated. Thus, in the exhibition, Vase with Thistles and Plate of Cakes of 1951, if you look closely, you can identify the separate pieces from which the vase was made: kiln furniture, a pottery vase, a metal handle, and the objects also which made up the thistles: scrap metal, spikes, nails, held together with wire. Bronze casting and you have the bronze cast of that sculpture in the exhibition. Bronze casting not only renders the fragile assemblage permanent, it also unifies the surfaces and it veils the disparate nature of the component parts. And Picasso himself could never decide whether or not he preferred these sculptures in their original plaster form, like this, or cast in bronze. On the other hand, some of the works of this period were not complete until each component had been cast in bronze and the whole welded together. This is true of Woman with a Key of 1953-54. Here is Picasso assembling the sculpture from pieces of kiln furniture in his studio. It's lying on the floor. But until it was cast into bronze, it couldn't stand up. It wasn't complete. So bronze casting in that case was essential. Other sculptures were not complete until they had been cast and painted. For example, the crane of 1951, which is decorated with black and white paint. The painted bronzes made in Valoris are in this regard like the absinthe glass and other cubist constructions in which pictorial elements, color and drawing play a very important role. Once again, Picasso was breaking through the conventional boundaries between three-dimensional sculpture and two-dimensional painting. After 1955, when Picasso moved into La Californie, a huge villa in Cannes with his new mistress, Jacqueline Roque, his activity as a sculptor diminished, although he continued to produce a lot of ceramics. It did not come to an end, however, and there was a spate of large but rough wooden constructions in 1956-58. And after that, a few modeled pieces made in plaster and painted and sheet and folded sheet iron sculptures made in the early 1960s. But those sheet iron sculptures fall outside the subject of this lecture since they do not involve assemblage. And so I'm going to end with one of his last wooden sculptures. Man, which was made in 1958. This can be interpreted as a symbolic self-portrait, for it evokes both an easel and a stretcher. Stretcher, the easel for the canvas. And as such, these are the accoutrements of the painter, the painter being identified with his equipment. Yet it is also a life-size sculpture. And as such, it registers Picasso's pride in being both a painter and a sculptor, like his hero, Michelangelo. In its combination of four-square ruggedness and also extreme fragility, it cannot stand up by itself. It has to be propped up against a wall. And it looks as if it would fall apart if you knocked into it. In its extreme fragility, it's a touching testimony to his sense of both the indomitable nature of human creativity, painting, sculpture, making things, and also man's essential vulnerability. For this man is also a skeleton man, and as such is a reminder of the inevitability of death. Picasso never shirked his duty to be true to the unalterable facts of life in his art, even though he was notorious for refusing to face up to them in his everyday experience. And as you may know, Picasso never made a will, during his lifetime because he thought that if he made a will, he would instantly die. But in his work, those references to death come out quite strongly. And in a work like this, A Symbolic Self-Portrait, I think they're present too. Thank you. Now, if anybody wishes to ask questions, I'd be very happy to answer them. If you're speaking in Turkish, there is something here. If you're speaking in English, there's no problem for me.
Evet, soru sormak isteyen bu ilginç konferansa. Bir kere ben her şeyden önce teşekkür ediyorum Profesör Elizabeth Holding'e. Bir kısmını seyrettiğimiz sergide heykellerin nasıl oluştuğunu ve seyredemediklerimizi, yayınlardan bildiklerimizi daha ayrıntılı öğrendik. Çok teşekkür ediyorum kendisine. Muhakkak soracak bir şeyler vardır. Acaba...
Yes.
In Picasso's sculpture, is it only an issue of two dimensions?
Can you speak up a bit? I'm sorry, I can't hear.
I'm going to have to yell into this. Can you hear me now?
No,
because
not really.
He has to hear me too in order to translate it into Turkish.
Bunu kullanmam lazım çünkü Türkçe'ye çevirmesi için çevirmeni de duymasın.
I'll try and hear you.
Tamam, o zaman çaba
göster. The paint on his sculpture, where there is some paint, is the texture of that paint and the actual painting important? Or is it, are his sculptures somehow paintings in relief, or are they just important for their form? Can you talk a little bit about that?
I think, I hope I'm going to answer you rightly. One thing I should say straight away is that all the painting you see on Picasso's sculptures is done by him. I think myself that one of the things he's very often trying to do is to break down the barrier between painting and sculpture. And so painting becomes very important on freestanding sculpture as a way of linking even freestanding sculpture with painting, bringing it back to painting. One of the things that he loves doing, as I tried to show, were relief sculptures for the wall. They obviously hang like a painting on the wall, and some of the relief sculptures have frames around them, rather than being free in shape. They're rectangular. So that's another way that he actually does this. Something which is difficult to demonstrate, but that I might be able to demonstrate by going backwards. Well, perhaps here. One of the things he does with paint on sculpture, as well as making it more like painting, making sculpture more like painting, is to emphasize shape so that you're more aware of the three-dimensionality as well. These marks here suggest the movement round the body of the bird, as well as actually describing the plumage of the bird. So it's descriptive, but it also gives you a sense of volume. Try to go back. And this is a very long answer to your question. This is it. In this relief, this wall relief, which hangs on the wall, the painting, I think, gives a sense of movement so that you imagine the movement, the rhythm of the guitar.
But one of the other things that he does is to use paint to emphasize projection or recession. The white tends to move forward as it's the lightest color. And this is in fact the front plane of the sculpture. So it's exaggerated that sense of three-dimensionality through the use of black and white paint. So he uses color like a painter uses it to describe form, three-dimensional form, and to increase the sense of depth, etc. Pictorial means. But I think it was very important to him, the whole idea of painting sculpture.
Çok önemli onun için dolayısıyla boyama heykeller üzerinde.
Ben bir şey soracaktım.
Turkish.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Professor, can you hear me?
Yes.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, yeah. I can.
Okay.
Bir şey soracağım.
I would like to ask a question. With regard to sculpture,
heykellerini çok beğenirim.
I like Greek sculpture very much. I like modern sculpture too, but when modern sculpture is made, what is the meaning of using everyday objects? Aren't there problems with this? Well, a sieve, for instance, or a spoon, those objects that Picasso uses, when he uses these, what does he want to tell us? Can't he express what he wants to tell us through these by modeling or shaping the material himself as an artist?
Very good question.
Çok güzel bir soru.
The answer is he could shape it and model it. That head of Fernand I showed you at the beginning is modeled. You can't go on making Greek sculpture forever. You have to do something different. I think for Picasso, one of the things that was always very interesting about sculpture was that he felt it was like a kind of artisanal technique. It was, you could work with your hands. And one of the things he wanted to do through sculpture, I think, was to show that sculpture can be made by people who are not trained sculptors. People who appreciate and make use of the ordinary things in this world. I tried to suggest that the construction technique was using techniques that we find in furniture. Tables, chairs are constructed. Violins are constructed, guitars are constructed. One of the things I think he wanted to do was to show that sculpture could be constructed like ordinary things. And this was part of an admiration for things themselves, a love for things, but also a love for the people who made things, the artisans who make things, a sense of respect for them. And I have to say too, you say spoons, things like that, why use these things? Picasso always did something with them. They don't remain spoons, they become something else as well. There's a transformation. That's the sort of surrealist side of him, the poetic side. But there's also, I think, a real love of those things. I mentioned briefly cardboard boxes, He loved boxes. He never threw away a cigarette packet, a cardboard cigarette box, because he thought they were so beautifully made. And there are records of him saying, look at this beautiful little wooden box in which something came. Look how beautiful it is. And I think one of the things that he may be doing in his sculptures with found objects is not just transforming them, showing respect for the people who made them, but actually showing a kind of love for the things themselves. He could make use of them. It's a sort of magic idea. But it's also too, to come back to your question, it's also a feeling that he had that sculpture needed to be invented again. It needed to be reinvented. And because he wasn't a professional sculptor, because he wasn't a trained sculptor, he had a feeling of freedom that a trained sculptor might not have had. So you may never like it. but one thing I would say to you is that Picasso did love classical sculpture too. That piece I showed you. It's very small. It's like that. It's not a classical sculpture, but it is a kind of homage to classical sculpture on a small scale, done with a great deal of wit. You might see it as a travesty, you might see it as a joke, you might see it undermining classical sculpture, but I think it's also full of love for classical sculpture. And he did keep classical sculptures. He had some pieces. So there's a lot of humor. I think one thing, one of the problems with Picasso's work, and particularly his sculpture and his ceramics, is that it's very funny. A lot of it's funny. And I don't know whether this is true here, but certainly in Europe, in the West, thinking of the Western tradition, people have great difficulty in thinking that visual art can be and should be funny. Literature, yes. We're used to laughing. But sculpture, that you should laugh, that you should be amused. This is not considered very proper. And things like this, I think, are very witty. They're very amusing, as also very lovely when you see it.
Thank you. I have a question. In the start of your lecture, you were mentioning that his constructive sculptures had a decisive influence on the future of sculpture. And my question is, why? Is it the reinvention of sculpture? Is it the love for ordinary or daily objects, or is it his respect for the artisan? In what decisive way was the future of sculpture influenced by
it? Was it revolutionary?
Yes.
Well, I mean, it's a very good question. Up until those constructions were made by Picasso, and the ones that were made by Braque, which are lost, so we don't know them. Up until that point, sculpture had been either modeled or carved. Sometimes a mixture of the two, but, you know, modeled or carved. And when the constructions were first illustrated and first exhibited and so on, they struck people as just a revelation that this was another way of making sculpture, from finding, putting together, working in a different kind of way. So that although there are many sculptors who have never adopted that practice, the fact is that since they were discovered, since people started to imitate Picasso, it has been forever, it's gone on and on. And very often, on a very big scale, the two pieces I showed you by Anthony Caro, they're huge. They take the whole of this stage. Picasso never worked on that scale. But they could see how they could take his method of working, of construction, and take it onto a kind of really architectural, environmental scale. I don't know if it answers your question, but it happened.
Sorunuza cevap mı bilmiyorum ama böyle.
Ben bir şey soracağım.
I would like to ask something.
I will talk in Turkish.
Ben bir şey soracağım. Picasso'nun bu ekleme, bulma ve oluşturmak
this finding, fixing and transforming
Joseph Beuys'a giden yolda acaba
well, from here to Joseph Beuys,
çizgi neydi?
What Joseph was the line?
Kendisinin çünkü
because Joseph Beuys
karşılaştırmalı sergiler yaptığınızı biliyorum.
I know that you sometimes have comparative exhibitions. Matisse Picasso, I've seen one. Matisse Picasso. In this kind of comparison, if you take Picasso as your point of departure and move all the way to Joseph Beuys, what exists in between? Are there many followers? Perhaps it would be interesting for the audience.
I think in the case of Joseph Beuys, the great predecessor is not Picasso. It's Marcel Duchamp. And probably the other artist who has had the most influence, the other early 20th century artist who's had the most influence on later developments is probably Marcel Duchamp. Conceptual art is inconceivable without him. Interestingly, Marcel Duchamp himself started his main career as a cubist painter, really, following Picasso. Then he gives up painting, and he does use construction techniques which have some influence of Picasso in them. But then his work moves on to the level really of thought, of conception, of the idea behind the work being more important than the work itself. And indeed, Marcel Duchamp pretended that he wasn't making any work anymore, that he'd given up work. So they start, or Duchamp starts in the sort of position of a kind of follower of Picasso, cubist work before the First World War. He uses found objects, but then he diverges. And Picasso himself always felt that making art was really, really important. In that way, he's a very traditional artist. He continued to believe in painting. Duchamp gave up painting in 1918, no more painting. Picasso was painting almost to the day he died. When he's 91, he's still covering huge canvases. He believed in painting. He continued to believe in making sculpture. And he, I have to say, had a horror of two things. One thing was abstract art. For him, art always had to have some connection with the real world. It might be very far away from ordinary appearances, but it had to have some connection with the real world. And you see that in his very late paintings here. The other thing he hated was conceptual art. He didn't like Marcel Duchamp's work at all, because he believed an artist had to work with his hands, he had to make things, he had to carry on being creative. So I think that, you know, had he known the work of Joseph Beuys, and I don't think he probably had any idea about it, he wouldn't have liked it at all, and he would have known that it was not coming from him, it was coming from this other tradition, this sort of anti-art tradition.
What was he thinking about the relationship between the sculpture and the base?
And the base?
Yes.
It's a very interesting question too. There are not very many sculptures by Picasso, three-dimensional freestanding sculptures, which are very experimental in the use of bases. Sculptures tend to be given bases by him. There are a few pieces which lie on the top of the table rather than stand. You may remember I showed you a bather in plaster. She lies, but she has a base. I think where he's more original is in the importance that he gives to the idea of relief.
Burada önemli olan
of not freestanding sculpture, but relief sculpture. If I go back to this. This is very small, this size. You might think it was three-dimensional, fully freestanding. It is three-dimensional, but you might think that it was something you could walk around. That's not right. The back of it is not painted at all. He thinks of it as a three-dimensional relief that comes very far out into the space. But it should be seen not in the middle of a table, but say on a mantelpiece with a wall behind it. It's something that is very three-dimensional, but is still attached to the wall. And in that sense, it's like painting. And of course, he paints it as if it were a painting. So I think his originality is not in the treatment of the base, but in the treatment of relief, and giving relief so much importance, and so often making elements project right out into the space of the spectator, not remain, you know, the relief doesn't sort of lie flat like this, it comes right out. And that's where I think the originality is. So you can walk around this piece, but not all the way around it. And this is true as well for this, but even for this sculpture, which is freestanding, but you see she's on a base. But in fact, the sculpture is much better from the front and where Picasso is, sort of walking round like this. The back of it is not so interesting, it's rather flat. It's almost like a relief again. And you get the sense, I think, that this, the back of the plinth, is the back of the work, and the projection is that triangle, if I'm making sense. But it's an interesting question, and I think you're going to have a Rodin exhibition here soon. Very interesting, I mean, wonderful sculptor. But of course, he was really inventive in getting away from the base in some of his sculptures.
We thank you indeed. I think there are no more questions. We thank you so much for that very, very interesting.